In 2023, Warner Brothers shelved a fully completed film based on one of their biggest mascot IPs, refusing to release it because they thought that writing it off as a $30 million tax deduction would be more profitable than putting it out into the world. When the people who worked on the movie tried to share some of what they did for their resumes and demo reels, they were copyright struck and threatened with legal action. This was one of the first things WB did after a nationwide strike of writers, artists, and actors lobbying for protection against exploitation through corporate chicanery and the looming specter of AI art, in response to which one of the only media companies bigger and more powerful than Warner Brothers said, and I quote, "We're gonna starve them out until they have to sell their apartments." We're at a crossroads right now. Artists and creators have to stick up for each other and watch each other's backs. We really ought to be creating an atmosphere of camaraderie and support. And the last thing we need right now is some petulant jackass to look at art that creators poured their heart and soul into and found popular and financial success with, only to say, "Wow, that sucked. You're really bad at this." And to that, I say, fuck you, Bob Iger, and hee-haw, motherfuckers. Let's do this.
It's a bad idea, right? It's a bad idea, right? It's a bad idea, right?
But I still wanna party.
Fuck it, it's fine.
Last night we lit the liquor.
Maybe together we can get some.
When you get it, but good at that, those will pull me out.
Two cool guys.
I'm so mature, I'm so mature.
In the back of the nightclub, sipping champagne.
It's a bad idea, right? It's a bad idea, right?
Hey guys, Sean Fay-Wolfe of Diamond X Studios here, and for those of you who are new to the channel, welcome. I'm the guy who makes countdown formatted video essays where I discuss popular music from the past and present, doing things like ranking all the number one hits of the 2000s, discussing giant British hits Americans have never heard of, and making top 10 best and worst songs of the year lists for dozens of years reaching as far back as the 1960s. On top of that, at the end of every year, I join a whole glut of other people, many of whom are friends of mine, to make videos counting down the top 10 best and worst songs of the year that just finished. I typically try to turn these year-end videos into huge, extravagant spectacles where I put on the biggest show that I can. But this year, I've decided to reel things in a bit. I've been absolutely buried with grad school work over the past few months, and literally the first weekend I had after I finished all that work, I got my ass kicked by COVID, which I'm still recovering from. So this year, I'm not doing anything big besides that intro bit. No cameos, no stunts, just a guy sitting on his couch talking about pop music. I'm not gonna lie though, even if I had all the time in the world, I don't think I'd be making a big fuss over the pop music of 2023. Typically when I discuss a year of music in one of these videos, I try to find some kind of narrative through line to explain why the popular music scene was the way it was during that year, but for 2023, I got nothing. I mean, I guess I can't really be surprised by that. Last year, I declared that 2022 was the year that pop music died. So can I really be shocked by what the following year gave me? Man, I'm sorry. This corpse is just not doing anything interesting today. Yeah, this turned out to be a pretty opportune year for me to pack up all my shit and move to the other side of the country and subsequently pay a lot less attention to pop music. And that's not because nothing interesting was happening in the music world, quite the opposite, in fact. No, it was because I knew that none of the interesting things happening were going to lead to anything bigger, because nobody has any idea what pop music even is right now. I truly do believe that 2022 marked the end of the pandemic era of music. TikTok is no longer the hot new tastemaker launching indie artists past industry gatekeepers into the stratosphere. We live in a post-ABCDEFU world where TikTok has been fully assimilated into the pop music engine, and now everyone's just in a free-for-all trying to figure out what the next hot sound is gonna be. You see this kind of turbulent period pop up all the time throughout music history. After the breakup of the Beatles in the 70s, after the death of disco in the 80s, after everyone got sick of MTV in the 90s, when the biggest trends of music come to a screeching halt, and everyone is like, okay, so what the hell are we gonna do now? These periods of uncertainty have always caused pop music to become a sloppy goop of turgid comfort and familiarity, with a few bizarre micro-trends sprinkled around on top of it. And if you look at the pop music of 2023, that is exactly what you see. Songs from more than a decade ago getting huge airplay, trap music getting outcharted by folk singers, the biggest radio hit of the year being sung half in Nigerian patois and somehow not feeling remotely unusual or out of place, the entire top 40 being filled with Mexican corridos for like 3 months, and country music hitting number one on the Hot 100 for the first time in decades because it's the only genre that's a real established institution right now, while everything else is just a bunch of segmented fire fests which make a splash and then immediately get torn down. The music scene this year was like watching a car crash in slow motion, with a whole bunch of interesting moving parts you can focus on that still amount to an overall picture of total chaos. And yet, while I know the chaos isn't going to amount to anything long-term in terms of trends, in terms of quality, all of this somehow amounted to one of the most balanced years of pop music I can remember. 2023 had a good number of really amazing big hits, a good number of ungodly awful big hits, and a perfectly healthy amount of mid to balance everything out. I'll be looking at all these huge hits over the next couple months, but today, we're going to be taking a look at the absolute worst of the worst that our nation decided to reward with popular success. Keep in mind, I'm not going into this just looking for bad songs to shit on, I'm looking to shit on enormously popular bad songs. The songs eligible for this video are anything that made Billboard's list of the 100 biggest songs of the year, anything that made the year-end top 100 of Lydia Valentino's more streaming-driven V30 chart, or anything that hit the top 20 on the radio. I'm aware that the Billboard charts are getting less and less relevant to the actual tides of popular taste with each passing year, however, the following remains true. Whatever songs you were listening to, millions more people were listening to the songs on this list. We're going to be looking at a finely curated platter of garbage today, ranging from the lame to the annoying to the genuinely offensive. So all I ask you to do is to please keep an open mind and really consider what music we consider bad and why. If you had asked people 15 years ago what the worst songs of all time were, two of the first answers you likely would have gotten were Barbie Girl by Aqua and Blue Dabba Dee by Eiffel 65. I mean, they're so stupid and annoying. How could anyone possibly like them, right? Yeah. Anyway, in 2023, both Barbie Girl and Blue Dabba Dee were sampled and basically remade. Both of them became smash hits far more successful than the originals were in their time, and neither of them will be appearing on this worst list, a choice I doubt most people will have a problem with. The times, they are a-changin'. So let's take a look at the times when the white toast landed buttered side down as we dive into...
When I wake up...
The top 10 worst hit songs of 2023. Number one is Jason Aldean.
Try that in a small town.
Yeah, there's no surprise this year. No point trying to build it up. Anyone who knew this song existed going in saw this coming. This is the worst hit song of the year, and anyone who says otherwise is simply incorrect. You want to argue that this doesn't count as a real hit? You're wrong. This song debuted at number 2 on the Hot 100, and the week after that, it went to number 1. America dipped their toes into the water, and we liked how it felt. It hit the top 10 of the streaming charts, it dominated the sales charts, and it received widespread radio play. For a few weeks in August of 2023, the most popular song in the United States was an actual, literal lynching anthem.
Try that in a small town. See how far you make it down the road.
If you think it's not a lynching anthem, you don't know the definition of the word. Lynch, for a mob to kill someone for an alleged offense without a legal trial. This is a song where Jason Aldean says that if you do something he and his conservative buddies don't like, they are going to round up a posse and extrajudicially murder you. As recently as the Clinton administration, the things those conservative lynch mobs didn't like were people of color existing. Don't worry though, 25 years ago is the past. I'm sure all the conservatives forming lynch mobs are much less racist these days.
Round here we take care of our own. You cross that line, it won't take long for you to find that our
I recommend you don't.
Oh, but that's just a vague warning. He's not actually threatening to kill you. Yeah, he is.
Got a gun that my granddad gave me. They say one day they're gonna round up.
I have a gun. They'll never take it from me. And if you piss me off, fuck the system. I'm coming after you. Oh, wow. I guess anyone Jason Aldean might not like for whatever reason, better get out of this town. Thanks to him and his buddies, this doesn't seem like a safe place to be at night. Hell, it might even be fitting to call it a sundown town, perhaps.
Driving in a small town full of good old boys. Raised up right.
Oh yeah, look at me, I'm Jason Aldean. I'm such a big, strong man who doesn't take shit from anyone.
If you're looking for a fight, try that in a small town.
I am just salivating for the chance to be a good guy with a gun. Especially when I'm the guy who gets to decide what good is. Never mind that when someone actually goes to do harm in a small town, the so-called good guys with guns are more than happy to stand around and let down the innocent people they're supposed to protect. Now, ignore all that shit. Jason Aldean is the one who knows what a real man is.
Well, that shit might fly in the city. Good luck.
Yeah, a real man is someone who knows how to stand his ground and protect his castle without ever leaving it. I mean, after all, those big cities are so scary because that's where the liberals let all the big scary criminals run wild. So yeah, fuck that noise. He's just gonna hunker down in the middle of bumfuck nowhere, building a fort of bluster and machismo that will never be put to the test. Like a child building a fort of pillows that he knows dad isn't gonna be able to knock down no matter how hard he tries. If you think that Jason Aldean is what a real man is supposed to look like, well, all I could say is I hope you're having a fun life, scowling at your phone every time you remember President Brandon exists, being too chicken shit to travel more than 10 miles away from home, being the best damn keyboard warrior you can to really make a difference as your days slowly tick away. Keep yelling into the void about how day by day you're losing the world of lazy comfort you once had, the world that never challenged the way you think. Keep being petrified of change, building up straw men of anyone who calls you out, and soaking in the cheers of your echo chamber as you knock them all down like bowling pins. Have fun role-playing as a badass vigilante who murders any threat to your sacred traditional values through the eyes of this washed-up, doughy grifter who's such a good, respectable Christian man that his last big hit before this was about how he doesn't miss his ex-wife or kids after he dumped them for a woman 10 years younger than him. And as for you, Jason Aldean, well, all I can say is keep on trying to fill that void where your soul should be. Because at the rate you're going, I don't think God's gonna be too merciful when the time comes to judge what he finds in that spot. So, yeah. That's that. Try That in a Small Town by Jason Aldean is the worst hit song of 2023. In fact, this song is so far removed from the realm of any other song on this list that, you know what? This isn't even number one on the list. This is number zero on the list. Try That in a Small Town by Jason Aldean, the number zero worst hit song of 2023. Yeah. Yeah, that feels right. Man, that's good to get that off my chest. I've been holding that one in for a while now, as you can probably imagine. But hold up, I know what you're probably thinking. Wait a second, wasn't there another right-wing country song that everyone couldn't stop talking about this summer? Didn't that one also hit number one on the charts out of nowhere? And wasn't everyone also talking about how that was one of the worst songs of the year? Shouldn't that one be tied with Jason Aldean for the number zero worst hit song of the year? Well, no, because you see, that one is actually the number 10 worst hit song of the year.
These rich men, north of Richmond, Lord knows they all just wanna have total control.
Yep. That's right, Rich Men North of Richmond, the song that probably made a lot of you click on this video, the world-famous Fudge Round song, is number 10 on the worst list. Which I'm sure is going to be a surprise to, well, pretty much everyone, honestly. A lot of you are going to be shocked this isn't tied with Jason Aldean at the top spot. A smaller but still substantial number of you are probably pissed at me for putting this on the list at all. Why do I think that it is bad, but only barely bad enough to make the list at all? Well, you see, here's the thing. I really don't like doing what I just did to Jason Aldean in that last segment too often. I got pretty fucking serious during that segment because that was the tone that a song like that requires, but I wish I didn't have to. I always try to keep things as upbeat and fun as possible on this channel. I prefer to make fun of shitty music by making fun of it, not verbally assassinating the guy who made it. Rich Men North of Richmond is a song that I have a solid 3 pages written about, almost all of which is very serious, analytical, and to the point with hardly any levity at all. And quite frankly, I'm afraid that making you watch all that immediately after the Jason Aldean rant will not only grind this video's pacing to a halt, but also scare away pretty much any new viewers from this channel forever. And so, what we're gonna do now is we are going to take this screaming beard child and just put a pin in them for now. We're going to skip this song for now, and I'm going to go through numbers 9 through 6 on the worst list. And then we're going to save the Richmond North of Richmond segment as the finale of part 1 of this countdown. I think that's a good way to format this video. It's just like Oliver Anthony's face. A bunch of wacky, silly shit in the middle, and a big problem we have to have a serious talk about on both ends.
It's like poetry, it's sort of, they rhyme.
Indeed it does. Anyway, enough stalling. Let's move on now and take a look at...
When I wake up in my own pink world, I get up out of bed and wake up to my homegirls. Hey, Bobby.
Hey.
Why so stressed? Could it be those irrepressible thoughts of death?
About a month ago, Harvard University announced that they would be offering an elective course analyzing the legacy of Taylor Swift. I replied to that announcement saying that, duh, Taylor Swift is the biggest musical phenomenon since Michael Jackson, and it makes complete sense to study that phenomenon academically. This prompted a lot of outraged responses, saying that it was blasphemous for me to even mention Taylor in the same sentence as MJ. Guys, when Taylor Swift flew to Brazil for the Eras Tour, the city of Rio lit up the Christ the Redeemer statue with a welcome message so that Taylor would see it as she flew in on her private jet. Let me repeat that. One of the biggest countries in the world, a country where most people don't speak English, heard that Taylor Swift was flying in for a concert and said, "Oh shit, we better make sure Jesus is ready for her." Y'all, it's time to stop pretending. Taylor Swift is as big as Michael Jackson. She is as big as Madonna. She is as big as the Beatles. I'm not saying she's as influential as they are, but she is definitely on their level in terms of popularity. I feel like a critic is always sticking their neck out whenever they put a currently popular artist on the same level as chronicled legends of pop culture, but I don't feel like I'm sticking out my neck here because it's just demonstrably correct. In the 2020s, everyone has their own little algorithm-curated media ecosystem, which has made it nearly impossible to have generation-defining superstars like those from the more monocultured media of the 20th century, but Taylor Swift managed to bypass all this segmentation to become a truly universal force. There have been exactly 2 weeks in history where the top 10 songs on Billboard's charts were entirely made by women, and they were the weeks Taylor dropped her last two albums and took up every spot by herself. Every time a major world event happens, it's not uncommon for people to wonder, gee, I wonder what Taylor Swift thought about that. And whenever she emerges from her castle to make a comment on anything, it becomes national news. 1989 TV is becoming the fastest-selling album of the 21st century, and it is a remaster. Other modern artists may be more artistically influential or even beloved, but no one else in the past 30 years has reached the sheer, radiant, gravity-bending heights of pure, indisputable, zeitgeist-warping death grip on the public imagination like Taylor Swift. And the most fascinating thing is that she did it not by playing to trends, not by leading a whole bunch of other artists in her wake, but by being an insular, neurotic weirdo who just happens to be exceptionally good at putting the inner monologue of a white millennial woman to paper in an engaging way. Whether she's reflecting on her relationship with others, telling cool stories she came up with, or even just reflecting on the anxieties of being the biggest entertainer alive, Taylor Swift's voice as an artist is truly unique, something that no one else is capable of replicating and that most people aren't dumb enough to try to rip off. Most people.
I'm picking out this dress, trying on these shoes, 'cause I'll be single soon.
In hindsight, it's genuinely amazing how much mileage Selena Gomez has been able to get out of her singing career. She comes from the same generation of pop girls as Taylor, both of them debuted on the charts at roughly the same time, though Selena has actually been in the entertainment business a lot longer than Taylor, hashtag Barney legend for life. At this point, Selena is a seasoned veteran of pop music. Speaking in pure numbers, she's the most successful pop star that the Disney Corporation has ever produced, which is amazing, because as an artist, her voice has always been pitifully weak.
I'm so sick of that same old love.
Throughout the past 15 years, Selena Gomez has been the go-to voice when you just need a female voice on a pop song, a tool to be plugged into the production kit of whatever engineers of pop radio the industry rotated in that year. There have been a few times where she's tried to step up and make artistic statements with her music, but at the end of the day, Selena Gomez is the woman who got the most liked photo on Instagram with a glamour shot advertising Coca-Cola, and that is exactly what her music sounds like. With that being said, though, if there was ever a year Selena could have broken out of that mold, it was 2023. Selena's remix of the Afrobeats hit Calm Down by Rima was the biggest radio song of the year, and that was the first time in 15 years that I thought a song was actually improved by Selena's presence on it.
Got you so high that you can't come down.
The role of the girl in that song required a veneer of shy passiveness masking an intense, fiery smolder just waiting to be unleashed. And not only did Selena play that part well, I can't think of anyone else who could have played it better. This was the role Selena had been waiting for all these years. It deservedly became her biggest hit of all time, and then she followed it up by completely ignoring that success and just making a D-tier Midnight's ripoff. I mean, that's all this is. Selena and her new boyfriend, Benny Blanco, saw Taylor Swift and Jack Antonoff completely break the music world in half with Midnights, and so they figured that the quickest way to build some actual hype around Selena's flaccid pop career was to just create something that sounds like Bejeweled and Lavender Haze got chewed up and regurgitated. The drums feel like they're spitting in your ear. The entire thing sounds like it's being run through a weird electric toothbrush filter. Never before has a Selena Gomez song sounded less like music and more like just a bunch of waveforms on a graph. Meanwhile, Selena's trying oh so desperately hard to bury what little unique voice she has and mimic Taylor's smirky, cheeky cadence instead.
Time to find another one, blame it on feeling young.
Not a bad impression, I'll give her that. She definitely sounds like a dedicated student who doesn't really care about what she's studying, but really does want to get an A+ so she has an extra tassel on her graduation cap. But I'm sorry, any attempt to make a Taylor Swift song by someone who is not Taylor Swift is just automatically doomed for failure. Taylor's songs work because she is a storyteller, a bard of her own legacy, who, whether she's telling her own stories, inventing them from fold cloth, or just commenting on something more generic, always lets you feel like you're reading intimate diary entries from the most interesting times in the life of a captivating writer. And I'm sorry, but if there is any singer in the world who does not have the right to that level of main character syndrome, it's Selena Gomez. Especially when it turns out that the shit Selena's writing in her diary is kinda shitty and immature.
Should I do it on the phone? Should I leave a little note in the pocket of his coat?
Yeah, that's the other thing about this song, the thing that pushed it over the edge and onto the list. The lyrics are just really not cool. She just goes on and on about how this guy is gonna be a miserable crying mess when she cuts it off with him, how she's gonna tell him she's leaving by maybe leaving a text message, or leaving a note in his coat pocket so she doesn't have to observe it directly. Don't get it twisted, she is well aware of how much this is gonna hurt him.
Maybe I'll just disappear, I don't wanna see a tear, and the weekend's almost here. I know he'll be a mess when I break the news, but I'll be single soon.
Honestly, she sings it like she's getting a kick out of how miserable he's gonna be after she springs a surprise dumping on him. Oh well, then I guess this guy must have been a real piece of shit, right? Nope.
Why not give a reason why? Oh well. We both had a lot of fun. Time to find another one. Blame it on feeling young.
This guy showed her an absolutely wonderful time. She's just leaving because she's bored of this toy and wants a new one. And she's gonna intentionally break the guy's heart, run away, and imagine him crying over her because that's just one more level of amusement for her. I mean, hey, what can I say? She's just high maintenance.
I know I'm a little high maintenance, but I'm worth a try.
It will not surprise you to hear that 4 out of the 5 writers of this song were men. But what might surprise you is that the one woman who wrote this song was not Selena Gomez. So what we have here is a group of people who thought the key to replicating the success of a Taylor Swift song was to have the woman singing have zero creative input on her words. Instead, leaving the task of writing to a bunch of men vomiting up nasty Valley Girl stereotypes while leaving the carry to a copy of Taylor's production that they got about 30% right. You never really appreciate what the A-listers are doing right till you hear the wannabes fuck it up, do you?
I'll be single soon.
Well, who's next?
Hey, Bobby.
Hey.
Why so stressed? Could it be those irrepressible thoughts of death?
Look, the late TikTok era has seen a whole bunch of developments that make pop music feel just a whole lot cheaper and less artful and a whole lot less fun to talk about and analyze, so I'm not gonna lie, it's almost a little bit comforting to still see solid representation from the shitty TikTok hack that started it all.
It's karma, it's my boyfriend. Karma is a god. Karma is the breeze in my hair on the weekend. Even though we're going through it and it makes you feel alone.
Yep, that's right. We're in 2023 and remix gaming is still here and as strong as ever. You know, you got a song that's doing pretty well on the charts, but then you wake up one day and you realize, man, I really like money, but I
wish that I had more of it than I do right now.
Well then, slap a new featured artist onto that song for a remix, giving the song an artificial boost to its numbers and a whole new lease on life, regardless of whether the new vocalist you've added fits well at all. You know what Doja Cat's beautiful, cooing seduction anthem Say So needed? Nicki Minaj should kill the beat and brag about how she lied about being bisexual for clout. You know what Savage Love by Jason Derulo needed? BTS to pop in and steal even more clout away from the kid Jason stole the beat from. You know what the newly repopularized Die For You by The Weeknd needed? Ariana Grande to step in and have no clue what the fuck she's doing for 2 minutes. You know what Taylor Swift's anthem about inner peace, balance, and karma needed? Grah!
I'm finding ways to stay concentrated on what I gotta do.
Now, these two remixes may be on the list for fundamentally the same reason, but the actual specifics of why I dislike both of them is actually quite different between them. Of the two of them, Karma is the one that I'm less mad about, so let's start with that one. To be honest, I don't even know if I would call this remix bad as a full product, per se, but a large part of that is probably because, over the course of 2023, the original Karma has evolved into one of my favorite Taylor Swift songs. This is probably my favorite use of the glittering sequin synth used throughout this whole project. It just sounds fantastic overall. But even more than that, I love what a monumental stepping stone this is in Taylor's journey and how well she captured it. Do y'all remember the last time that Taylor sung about karma?
The world moves on another day, another drama. But not for me, all I think about is karma.
Yeah, it was not good. Taylor Swift had basically collapsed into an insecure puddle of goo by 2017. She was a wet cat flailing out in all directions, thinking she had to counter the accusations being made against her at the time by going on the offensive. But now, half a decade later, she's balanced out and matured.
I keep my side of the street clean.
I was honestly kind of terrified when I saw there was a song on the album called Karma, only to be smacked across the face when the song turned out to be about how Taylor had learned that if she truly believed she was in the right, the best course of action was to ignore the haters and keep doing her thing, all expressed through some of the most endearing lyricism of her entire career. It was an extremely gratifying moment of self-actualization for Taylor, and honestly, it's made me proud of how far she's come as a strong, independent individual. And what does the remix add to this?
Karma is that girl, like...
Do y'all remember the cinnamon challenge?
Karma is your text about a bounce. Karma is a fire in your house.
You know, that thing where everyone took a teaspoon of cinnamon and shoved it straight into their mouth, thinking, oh, it's just cinnamon, I eat this stuff all the time, it'll be easy. Only to find themselves completely overpowered, sent straight into coughing fits, with some of them coming close to fucking dying. Yeah. As it turns out, sometimes even a little bit of spice is way too much.
So I keep my head up, my bread up, I won't let up. Never promise that you'll never endeavor with none lesser. Ever, ever.
This is embarrassing. Honestly, I wouldn't be surprised if Taylor and Spice knew this was embarrassing, and just let it happen anyway as a joke. Ice Spice was the viral breakout star of 2023, so I guess if anyone is gonna have a feature on a remix from the biggest album of the year, it's gonna be her. That makes sense. You know, if you've literally never listened to nor heard of either of these two women in your life.
Lamborghini wrong when I hop the chug, pretty bitch like Lauren with a big ass butt, yup.
Ice Spice's whole thing is that she's a laid-back goofball soaked to her core with Gen Z vibes who only gets cooler the less she tries. It's a tall order to get literally anyone to duet with the most insular, overthinky, try-hard pop megastar of all time, but Ice Spice clashes with Taylor's energy so hard she makes Taylor's song with Future sound like goddamn Sonny and Cher. Taylor is a good artist. She had to know that nothing about this remix was working. So, like I said, I imagine she and Ice Spice were snickering the entire time they were making this, just laughing the whole time as they couldn't believe this was actually happening. I mean, the only other explanation is that Taylor Swift invited Ice Spice onto her album to save face after her boyfriend Matt Healy caught a whole bunch of headlines for making racist jokes about Ice Spice, but really, what are the odds of that?
I'm finding ways to articulate the feeling I'm going through.
And then we have Die For You featuring Ariana Grande. And right off the bat, I just have to say that unlike the Karma remix, this one was not dead on arrival. I mean, after all, Ariana hopped on the remix of Save Your Tears from After Hours, and that remix was one of the biggest and best hits of the decade so far. I heard so many people try to compare the two remixes and say they were basically just the same thing, which boggled my mind, because to me, the Die For You remix fails in all the ways that Save Your Tears succeeded. First of all, the original Die For You is an ancient song. It literally came out before I started my channel. I know not all of you follow music that closely, so if you missed this little tidbit, Die For You was a flopped single off of Starboy from 2017, which gained a massive second wind of popularity through TikTok in late 2022, which led to this remix. The fact that this song is being remixed 7 years later does some weird things to it.
And you know I can't fake it now or never.
For starters, Ariana Grande and The Weeknd are two of the most dynamic and ever-evolving out of all the active pop megastars. They are both vastly different artists now than they were 7 years ago, so hearing 2017 Abel collaborating with 2023 Ariana just hits the ear weird. It's hard to put your finger on it, but you can just tell something is off about it. It's like watching that scene from Back to the Future where Marty's mom is hitting on him. It's just yuck. More concretely though, this song is mixed like total ass. This is just conjecture, but I honestly think the original stems for Die For You got lost at some point since the release of Starboy. This song does not sound like the Save Your Tears remix where they went in and rearranged the instrumentals to form a cohesive new version of the song. It sounded like they had a single audio track where Abel was singing and a single audio track where he wasn't, and they just had to work with it. They just had to find a way to squeeze Ari into what was already there, and they did not do that well. I mean, listen to this. You have the first chorus, all completely the same, the Weeknd solo with nothing changed whatsoever, and then the exact second that the chorus hits. I can't walk away. This is all just so graceless. It's so clear that nobody wanted to put another singer onto this song. They literally just had her sing along the exact same melody without even an attempt at harmonization. Hell, the vocals are so crunchy and compressed that a lot of the time you can barely even tell there are two different people singing. So Ari has to do all these obnoxiously flamboyant vocal runs like she's a teenager trying to show off singing the national anthem. I would die to you. It's not like her solo verse is any better either. Her attempts to play with the melody are dull as dishwater. She clearly isn't that comfortable with this style of staccato singing. And the few times she is able to bring a bit of legato in, she just sounds like a possessed radiator. Yeah, I know you do. Multiple people have gone on record and said that Ariana Grande is a wizard with Pro Tools, so I refuse to believe that this was her best effort. This entire thing stinks of an unpolished, half-finished effort made in a huge hurry to get a remix out while the song was still trending. Most of the time when a remix doesn't work, I'm happy to just dismiss it and go back to enjoying the original. But this remix is unique in the fact that the more I listen to it, the more I realize that I really don't like the original Die For You all that much either. The more I studied this to try and figure out what Ari was going for, the more the slow, pounding, monotonous beat and wailing siren of the chorus dug into my brain, to the point where now Die For You might have been a worse list candidate even without this remix. The circumstances around these two songs may be different, but they have one thing in common. Neither of these songs was built to be remixed. Karma is a song about personal growth and legacy by a woman who repels her collaborators like oil and water, and Die For You is an intimate declaration of heart-aching passion that would take a fundamental reworking to make sense as a duet. But then again, I don't even know why I'm bothering to point out the specifics here, because frankly, no one cares. Neither of these remixes were made to be good or coherent because they weren't made for the sake of art. These remixes are the Pokemon Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl of pop music. A pair of bare-bones, capital P, products. Extremely lackluster remix capitalizing on name recognition and nostalgia, which only barely adequately fulfill their functions, meant to fill a release schedule, make some quick cash, and then disappear.
Karma's gonna hold you down.
All right. We're a good ways into this video and you're still here, which I have to assume means that you like what I'm doing here at least a little bit. So if you could do me a favor and leave this video a like, as well as subscribing and hitting the bell for notifications of new uploads, that would be just wonderful. I know these like and subscribe reminders are annoying, but as it turns out, they actually work. So yeah, sorry. But yeah, the more interaction I get, the more likely YouTube is to share these videos with new people. So if you could just take a few seconds to leave those interactions and maybe think of a few comments you want to leave when the video is done, then awesome. I would really appreciate that.
Hey, Bobby.
Hey.
Why so stressed? Could it be those irrepressible thoughts of death?
Look, I'll be straightforward with you guys. This next one is on the list because I never want to see this man on the pop charts again as long as I live. And to be honest, it looks like I'm probably gonna get my wish. One of the most notable things that's happened over the last few years of pop music is that the new generation of hitmakers has well and truly started to claim their stake, while the holdover artists from the 2010s who are still around have started a slow but inevitable creep towards their ultimate fate as nostalgic legacy acts. Looking at the list of the biggest artists of the year, it's filled with hitmakers who weren't big hitmakers when I started my channel in 2017, who are either brand new or started out as genre stars who are just now having their big crossover moment. When it comes to the big hitmakers of the 2010s, 2010s, most of them who are still here are big the way Bon Jovi was big in the 90s. Still selling out arenas and having giant hits, but clearly relics of an era that's quickly slipping away. Really, the only pop megastars from the pre-Sean era still in peak relevance are Drake and Taylor, of course. But if he wanted to, I think Ed Sheeran could easily join those two. Sheeran is still far and away the most followed artist on Spotify. His album from 2021 did killer numbers and had two enormous smashes on both streaming and the radio. He easily could have had one of the biggest albums of 2023 if he wanted to, but he didn't want to.
We can't get burned out.
Yes, just like was prophesized by the titles, Ed Sheeran added to his fan base, then multiplied his fan base, then divided his fan base, then kept his fan base the same, and now, inevitably, it is time to lose his fan base. Sheeran's sixth album, Subtract, was basically his folklore, turning down the shiny, market-approved radio pop in favor of a spare, stripped-back folk record, even going so far as to recruit the same guy who produced Folklore, Aaron Dessner of The National. The obvious difference, of course, is that Taylor Swift, no matter how much you strip her back, is still Taylor Swift. She's got a voice like no other, and no matter what she does, she is impossible to stay away from. Hell, this is literally the third entry in a row I've talked about her in. Sheeran's entire appeal is that he's a silly little folk guy making fun, polished, radio-friendly pop songs. And when you take him out of that niche, he's just another folk singer.
More that I love, less that I feel.
I'm not saying he's bad at it, the album was pretty solid for what it was, but it was always going to be a commercial disappointment, and oh, it was, at least in America, becoming the number 169 album of 2023, below such blockbuster smashes as Pitbull's Greatest Hits, Donato by Yvonne Cornejo, and the goddamn Moana soundtrack. Whether it be of his own choosing, the shifting tides, or perhaps some combination of both, there's a very good chance that Sheeran's curtains may be closing in America. And to that, I can only say... good.
Just dancing with my eyes closed.
I'm just done. I'm sorry. I am done with Ed Sheeran being here. I am done with the radio constantly blasting out all of his blandest, most absolutely mediocre songs. I've got no beef with Ed Sheeran as an artist, but Ed Sheeran as a cultural phenomenon has ground down my patience to the bone. And Eyes Closed is the exemplar of why that is.
So I'll keep dancing with my
This is just dancing on my own for Louis Capaldi fans, and it's the worst attempt to recreate that song since Love Somebody by Maroon 5. It's got plenty of mom-approved bounciness, but none of the passionate desperation that a song like this needs. It's more like a butterfly trapped in a spider web, sad, hopeless, plucky in acceptance of its self-defeat. It's bouncing around not because it's aiming to accomplish anything, but because it has nothing else to do. There's no satisfaction or catharsis to be found in a single note, and the sheer, overwhelming, paralyzing intensity with which I don't want to listen to this is astonishing. It is the lamest thing I have ever heard from this man, which is astonishing considering this is the Shape of You guy.
I guess I could just pretend the colors are more than blue, but I lost more than my friend. I can't help but missing you.
The lyrics of Eyes Closed are just sad song, the sad song. It's just as lyrically inane as Perfect, but with none of the heart. For God's sake, I wish he would let out with something as iconic as Fill Up Your Purse at This Buffet and My Bedsheets Smell Like You. Say what you will about the singles from Divide, but he sounded confident and in control on them. Whereas here...
Step in the bar, it hit me so hard, or how can it be this heavy?
Sorry, Ed does not sound good here. He sounds brittle. Frail. Shriveled. He sounds like he's actually being possessed by the ghost of a dying old lady. I can practically hear the knitting needles in his hands as he enunciates. I wrote most of this entry thinking that this was a sad, flaccid breakup song. And, I mean, it's not that. The lyrics are so nondescript they certainly work as that if that's how you choose to take them. Upon researching, I did find that there was another layer to how this song came about, but frankly, that other layer kinda just makes things worse. This whole album is very personal to Ed, but Eyes Closed in particular was meant as a tribute to a very close friend of Ed's, hip-hop entrepreneur Jamal Edwards, who passed away in late 2022. This loss came in the midst of several other tragedies in Ed's personal life, and it clearly shook him to his core, as you can tell by his devastating freestyle rap F64.
People lie, but I just stopped, I haven't even wanted one, I can't get over this, it's fucked, man, I wish I'd known.
Yeah, go ahead and listen to that full thing if you want to have your heart torn apart. That's the kind of thing I would have expected from a song that addresses the loss, and that being the album's lead single should have been a captivating moment that really really set the tone for the project, but instead, Head took a demo he had been working on with Max Martin since 2018, a love song about how hard it is to move on after a breakup, and pounded it with a hammer until it fit into the mold of what he needed for a lead single, a song that makes vague mention of losing a loved one, but in a way so nebulous that it works as a breakup song, or really any kind of vague, marketable sadness.
Time is moving so slow, and I don't know what else that I can do.
That, more than anything, is why this sounds so profoundly empty to me. Sheeran's voice is being weakened by his genuine pain, but that pain doesn't feel authentic because it's being filtered through a bouncy Max Martin breakup song. These two halves are not congruent with each other, and they cancel each other out, turning what should be a heart-rending tribute to a lost loved one into forgettable radio filler on the level of Ghost by Justin Bieber and Wherever You Will Go by The Calling. Just to be clear, I don't think Sheeran or Aaron Dessner or Max Martin were morally in the wrong for doing this. It is no place of mine to judge how a man chooses to pay tribute to his lost friend. I'm just here to critique art, and when I hear Eyes Closed by Ed Sheeran, all I can hear are the ingredients for something beautiful being squandered at the altar of the pop machine, sacrificed so that this downbeat, melancholic folk album would definitely have at least one big crossover hit, and creating a turgid, watered-down mess in the process. Ed, please take a break. I need it, but more than that, I think you need it, man.
Oh, I keep dancing with my... Why so stressed? Could it be those irrepressible thoughts of death?
Over the past decade, it has become somewhat gauche to complain about the death of rock and roll. I mean, after all, there's still plenty of awesome rock being made if you know where to look for it, and the whole rockism argument where rock is the only thing that real music should aspire to be, it's got a lot of really gross and narrow-minded connotations to it, to the point where everyone who whines about the decline of rock these days is generally given nothing more than a dismissive eye roll. Honestly, though, there is a part of me that does get it. Things have changed. Rock and roll isn't the center of the world that all music revolves around anymore, and while there have been a lot of benefits to that, it's also perfectly reasonable to acknowledge that rock and roll is fucking awesome. A lot of aspects unique to its imperial era were dope as hell, and to lament that something really cool was lost over the course of natural evolution away from it. It's hard to pinpoint the exact moment that rock and roll quote-unquote died, but if you ask me, the final swan song for the era of rock is, and will always be, Use Somebody by Kings of Leon.
I've been roaming around, always looking down at all I see.
Hell. Fucking yes. Not only is this an awesome song in its own right, but there's a real sense of grandeur and finality about it. From the huge, arena-rattling sound of its infinitely layered guitars to its iconic Bruce Springsteen wails in the chorus, it was just a very special song that seemed to roll all the wonderful excesses of rock and roll into one single beautiful moment.
Someone like you.
In 2023, someone ripped off this song directly. They made it sound like this. Bring back real music, man.
If tomorrow I lost it all, and everything that I had was gone.
The genre that replaced rock as the default genre of American pop music was hip-hop. Out of all the current megastars of the new biggest genre on earth, Lil Durk is easily one of the most successful. And man, I don't know if I've ever seen a rapper get as big as he is while clearly having absolutely no idea of what he's trying to accomplish. Durk sprang up in the wake of Pop Smoke as the torchbearer who was going to turn drill music into a universal force, but it quickly became clear that evolving from a regional legend into an A-list chart topper had completely torn his brain apart. He spent the last 3 years shoveling out project after project, swerving back and forth between appealing to his core drill fans and his new pop audience, and only seeming to spread himself thinner and thinner with each move. Durk can't make a single pop-focused move without desperately signaling to his drill fans that don't worry, he's not abandoning them, and vice versa. It's a balancing act that he is not succeeding in, not the least of which because he decided that one of his main sources of pop income was to be the enabler of Morgan Wallen's trap addiction.
Keep it real, can you tell me now?
Tell me now.
Would you stand by me?
Morgan Wallen can't really afford to stop making songs with Lil Durk. After Durk was the first black guy who reached out to work with Wallen after the incident, he's basically Wallen's N-word sobriety chip at this point. That's a joke, to be clear. The two of them do seem to genuinely respect each other and like working together, but good lord do they bring out the worst in each other. Their last collaboration was a really douchey little pill of a song that had Wallen as abrasive as ever while Durk was as watered down as I had ever heard him, and so I guess they figured that to hit it even bigger, they'd just make a song about absolutely nothing while taking those exact same vocals and running them through the filter of world-renowned super producer and noted sexual predator, Dr. Luke.
Gave me another chance to prove she ain't playing with. So sorry for that.
I'm gonna spare you the Dr. Luke rant for now, you know, the fact he's still working after what he did to Kesha is reprehensible, yada yada, I've said it all before. But I'm sorry, here's my main question right now. Didn't Dr. Luke used to be good at making music? Isn't this the acclaimed protege of Max Martin who made Since You've Been Gone, You in Your Hand, Die Young, Teenage Dream, Dynamite, TGIF, all these classics of iTunes-era pop music? How did we get to the point where whenever he's not just being Gen Z Puff Daddy and pumping out lazy sample beats faster than they can enter his mind, he's making this, which just takes Broadway girls and smears it with Vaseline, creating this puddle of formless audio sludge?
How you gonna ride for me? Don't switch no sides with me.
I mean, for God's sake, I literally cannot even tell whose voice that's supposed to be. This isn't country, nor is it drill, it's content. That is its genre. Its genre is content. It's the audio equivalent of laying in bed at 4 p.m. watching an episode of The Office you've seen so many times that you know it by heart. Its sole purpose is to just numb your brain by pickling it in a juice of turgid familiarity. And as for the lyrics?
I lose it all, you stand with me. Amsterdam, I skip the red district.
Congratulations, man. You skipped the prostitution district for your girlfriend. How romantic of you. You got anything to add, Wallen?
When the world tries to keep me down, and there's nobody else around. Keep it real, can you tell me now? Would you stand by me?
Yeah. Okay, I'm just gonna translate this for you guys. Baby, if I get caught saying the N-word again, will you continue to suck my rod regardless?
Oh, honey, of course I will. Wait, what do you mean, caught?
If you ain't tryna be that, then be gone. If tomorrow I lost it all.
Stand By Me, a song by an abusive scumbag, a vocally active gang member, and a white guy banned for yelling slurs that doesn't have a single interesting bone in its body. I'm almost ashamed to admit that I'm disappointed. At least Chris Brown's music makes me feel things.
Baby, when shit get real, I need your loyalty.
Alright, and with that, we've officially reached the halfway point of this countdown. I'm going to be doing the dishonorable mentions all in part 2 of this video. So now, before we get to our final piece of unfinished business, I'd just like to quickly remind you guys that because I use copyrighted music in these videos, I have not made a single dime from YouTube in the half a decade I've been doing this. And so I am 100% dependent on my supporters on Patreon to make any sort of income from the vast amount of time and effort that goes into making these videos. If you enjoy what I'm doing here, even a small pledge on Patreon would be immeasurably helpful. Pledges start at just $1, literally just 4 quarters every time I upload. And aside from supporting me, you'll get tons of rewards for your pledges, such as voting for what I talk about next, access to a community of awesome people on my Discord server, early access to my videos before they premiere, and direct contribution to my videos through my Grab Bag Review series, my fan rankings, and several other community-driven projects I have in the works. Thank you so much for your support, and now, let's wrap this up.
I've been selling my soul, working all day, overtime hours for bullshit pay.
Ever since the song came out, I have been bombarded by people saying that Richmond north of Richmond and Try That in a Small Town were basically two halves of the same coin, representing everything wrong with country music. If you go to the Wikipedia page for Try That in a Small Town, the only link in the See Also section is to the page for Richmond north of Richmond. Clearly, this song has been magnetically drawn to the parts of people's brains where they store all their worst stereotypes about country music and the people who make it. And frankly, it is not difficult to see why. This was the third country song in a row to hit number one on the Hot 100 in 2023, after the first two were A, a song by the aforementioned N-word guy, and B, the aforementioned lynch mob anthem. Oliver Anthony was the first person to debut at number one on the Hot 100 after never charting any song on any chart prior, and that was mostly due to heavy promotion and endorsements from far-right shitbags on the Daily Wire, turning it into a conservative viral sensation. I mean, come on, do you really think it debuted at number one because there was just that big a market for Jeffrey Epstein dad jokes?
Wish politicians look out for minors and not just miners on an island somewhere.
Yeah, no, of course conservatives took like this to a fish to water. It's a white guy with an asinine beard in the middle of the woods yelling over a spare guitar about how the evil government is suppressing the good, decent working men like coal miners and factory workers. I completely understand why conservatives latched onto this, and why so many average onlookers took a quick look and just noped right out of the whole thing. However, I'm not gonna lie, I'm a bit disturbed by all the passionate music fans I've seen who have tried to passionately argue that this song is just as bad, if not worse, than the Aldean one. I'm just gonna say it. If you think that this song is anywhere near as bad as Try That in a Small Town, I think that that's a very ignorant opinion that lacks a lot of nuance and context. Oliver Anthony is not a far-right grifter, and he is not trying to pander to the far-right for money. I mean, for one, he literally told the conservatives trying to claim him that they could fuck right off, but honestly, even before he did that, I knew this guy wasn't some far-right nutjob. I've said it before, and I'll say it again. Oliver Anthony is the actual, literal voice of the average American. This is not a guy trying to spread division. This is a regular guy who is in pain and uses music as an outlet to express that pain. Jason Aldean made his song because he knows that stoking the fires of hate is a great way to make a lot of money really quickly. Oliver Anthony made his song because American workers are being exploited and it makes him fucking livid.
Wish I could just wake up and it not be true, but it is. Oh, it is.
Oliver Anthony is a working class man who has been through the system. He worked in industrial jobs for the past decade and was in an industrial accident that fractured his skull and left him unable to work. This is a man who tried to follow the American dream only to be betrayed and let down by his country, and he knows many others just like him. In fact, you wanna know which number one hit jumped into my head when I first heard Rich Men North of Richmond? Because it wasn't Jason Aldean.
I don't believe we're on the eve of destruction.
This is Eve of Destruction, a song from 1965 where some scraggly-looking white guy no one had ever heard of hit number one on the charts with a desperate, impassioned growl about the never-ending cavalcade of bullshit that American citizens at the time were facing. From the Vietnam draft to violence over civil rights to war and conflict in every corner of the world and the useless government who either did nothing or made the problems worse.
Handful of senators don't pass legislation, and marches alone can't bring integration.
Barry McGuire truly captured the screaming frustration of being a young person at that time. Just like Oliver Anthony truly captures the screaming frustration of being a normal American trying to get by right now.
'Cause your dollar ain't shit, and it's taxed to no end.
He's right. The average American can't afford basic necessities right now, even if they're being forced to work themselves to the bone, and we're all fucking sick of it. This is a song that deserved to exist, a song that deserved to hit number one, which just makes it all the more painful that he fucking blew it.
Lord, we got folks in the street, ain't got nothing to heat, and the obese milk and welfare.
Yep, you knew it was coming.
God, if you're 5'3" and you're 300 pounds, taxes ought not to pay for your bags of fudge rounds.
Okay, let's get this out of the way first, because it hardly matters. Did Little Debbie spill grape juice on a music executive's new suit or something? Is that why pop music over the past couple years has been dead set on ruining fudge rounds?
Oh, bounce to the out, pick it up, put it down, wanna put his nutty buddy in my fudge rounds.
Very funny. Okay, yeah, but seriously, this is one of the worst writing decisions that anyone has ever made in the history of pop music. Ever.
And the obese milk and welfare.
Oh yeah, I hate those rich New England yacht club guys always putting junk food on their EBT card. I'm sorry, is this song called Rich Men North of Richmond and also Fat Freddy South of the Cul-de-Sac? You specifically made a song devoted to how the rich people in power are screwing all the rest of us over, and you devoted most of the second verse to making fun of poor people who end up getting fat because they use their welfare dimes to buy the cheapest available grocery options. It is completely understandable to get fucking infuriated that welfare often pays more than minimum wage jobs, but to say that's a problem with welfare being too high and not minimum wage stagnating due to lobbying from wealthy CEOs on a song specifically written and titled as an attack on rich men? Like, what am I supposed to do with this?
Taxes ought not to pay for your bags of fudge rounds.
The reason people make fun of the fudge rounds bit isn't just that it's a cringy line or a forced awkward rhyme. People shit on this line and this song for the fence-sitting idea that, oh, we should help poor people, but, you know, not all of them. Letting his complex, balanced opinion on welfare take up the entire second verse of a song that's supposed to be about the billionaire elite working the rest of the population to death and burning down the planet kinda suggests that he views these two things as as remotely equal problems with remotely similar implications. Oliver Anthony had an opportunity to bring everyone together here, but he blew it by being pointlessly divisive. And quite frankly, once you stop making this a battle of rich versus poor and turn it into a battle of people like us versus people like them, well...
Living in the new world with an whole soul.
The soul of the world is changing, there are shadowy groups trying to control what we think, and it's a damn shame what the world has come to for people like us.
It's a damn shame what the world's gotten to for people like me, people like you.
On Oliver Anthony's YouTube channel, he has a playlist which he's still continuously updating called Videos That Make Your Noggin Bigger. After performing CPR to bring my soul back to life after it shriveled up from reading that title, I scrolled through it a bit, and look at that, we've got some Joe Rogan, a bit of Fox News, a bunch of weird pseudoscience shit about supplements. Oh, check it out, This Is How You Become Authentic by Jordan Peterson, that explains a lot. And oh, look at that, some sermons from Billy Graham, the famously anti-Semitic mega-reverend. Right next to the multiple 9/11 conspiracy videos, wondering whether Israel may have known about the attacks before they happened, whose comment sections are filled with people celebrating that their anti-Semitism is being validated. Yeah.
Lord knows it all, just wanna have total control. Wanna know what you think, wanna know what you do. And they don't think you know, but I know that you do.
Look, earlier in the video, I said that Oliver Anthony represented the voice of the average American. And the more I find out about this guy, the more I'm realizing that, as fucked up as that may be, I think that's the truth. I think that Oliver Anthony is a guy who got chewed up and spit out by the jaws of late-stage capitalism and is just pissed at the world and looking for answers as to how the world got so fucked up. The answers the guy has considered so far might be a sarlacc pit of yikes, but the fact that he's said multiple times that he believes diversity is America's greatest strength, despite how easy and profitable it would have been to play to his new right-wing audience, that tells me that he's not parroting racist welfare stereotypes because he hates minorities, nor is he spreading anti-Semitic conspiracy theories because he hates Jews. On a different day, I might be able to convert a good chunk of time to how horrifying it is that anti-Semitism has seen a big enough resurgence to be a go-to explanation that millions of so-called truth seekers get naturally railroaded towards, but that is a scab that I do not have time for, nor am I qualified to peel back. My point for the moment is that Oliver Anthony seems to me like a guy who doesn't want to hurt anyone, who really does think he's just having an honest discourse and just asking questions. I don't know the guy personally, I could be wrong about any of this, but it seems to me that the man is spreading harmful rhetoric, but he's doing it out of ignorance, not malice. And that, more than anything, is why I believe that this is one of the worst songs of 2023.
I've been selling my soul, working all day.
I think Oliver Anthony truly thought that he was making an anthem that would unite all disenfranchised Americans against the wealthy 1% taking advantage of us. And frankly, I believe that that's how millions of this song's listeners took it. However, the fact that the average American searching for answers leads him to a place where he blames welfare queens and puts together a playlist of anti-Semitic conspiracy theories is soul-crushing. When Eve of Destruction went to number one in 1965, it was lambasted by critics and moral guardians as anti-American for daring to speak out against the government. It was an anthem for the counterculture, and it represented a groundswell of civil liberty that would ultimately push the country into a much better direction in the following decades. And now, in 2023, our countercultural number one hit is a man who cries out in pain over the collective abuse by the rich, but whose brain has been so poisoned by the internet's ambient QAnon vibes that he only ends up turning his pain into yet another political wedge even when he's specifically trying not to. The man made a genuine attempt to speak to the pain of everyone, and wound up with an audience that got mad and abandoned him as soon as he clarified that he hated racism. And the saddest part is, how many Oliver Anthonys are out there? How many people have no hatred in their hearts and genuinely just want peace and prosperity for themselves and their neighbors, but end up unwittingly supporting and empowering the most loathsome people in the world? How many people would gladly be friends with someone in a minority group if they met them face to face, only to lambast that minority as a whole because a bunch of profit-seeking grifters succeeded in enrolling that minority into the same catamaran of others that includes the 1% they're justifiably furious at?
'Cause all this damn country does is keep on kicking them down. Lord, it's a damn shame.
Rich Men North of Richmond by Oliver Anthony is a bad song. It's not a terrible song. It succeeds in certain parts of what it sets out to do, and does so in a powerful and moving way. However, a good deal of its message ended up corrupted, and that's because it failed to avoid the traps that the real rich men north of Richmond set up for people like me, and people like you. And what hurts me the most about all of this is that out of all the crazy shit that happened in 2023's pop music that I know will lead nowhere, I know that this is the song that will have a legacy. This is the moment the silent majority spoke up. A man no one heard of debuted at number one out of nowhere with a song that sounded like Brother Can You Spare a Dime. This was an insane moment that will never happen again, where we plucked the average American out of the woods and gave him the biggest platform that we could. This was a guy who managed to cut through all the algorithms and fake social media filters so much popular art is forced to go through. He had the nation's eyes on him. This was the chance for our generation to use our art to make a direct statement. And this was the statement that we made. Richmond, North of Richmond will go down in history as the most successful populist anthem of our generation, and its main legacy will be trying to carve out which parts of the 99% count as populist and which ones don't. How very American.
I've been selling my soul, working all day, overtime hours for bullshit pay.